Welcome to Berean Bible Church. We're so glad you're with us. And again, if you're a visitor with us, please come back and welcome yourself. Let us welcome you at the welcoming table. We'd love to see you. We're going to start our service today with the advanced bell choir. So let their play begin to set your hearts toward worship. The different handbell groups will be performing this morning, so I hope you'll enjoy them. But as far as announcements concerned, of course, we're only a week and a day away from starting to build the Nativity, which means it's coming up really soon. So some very important things. One is the signs are here. If you didn't pick one up last week, again, it comes with the legs. It's back there on the left behind the welcome table. So if you have a place in the business or perhaps you have a number of cars that go by your house, that would be a great place to put it. So please stop and pick up one of the signs and get us started there. Also, in your bulletin today, you'll see that there is a flyer, and there are plenty more of these available in the back. We can print more. These are flyers for you to hand out to your friends or mail out. And maybe if you're mailing Christmas cards this week, that would be great because they'll have it in time and they'll see when the event is. So December 18th, 19th, and 20th. And also for sign-ups, of course, we need food for feeding the staff and the actors here. But today, after the service, we'll have projected on the back wall the sign-ups. We have that set up now. If you haven't signed up yet, we still have need for some actors, especially men, to fill in our disciples and the wise men. And we'll pretend you're a wise man, put you out there and dress you up really nice. But we need actors for those events. So please don't forget about serving the Lord in this great evangelistic ministry. We have some great giveaways that we're giving to the folks in the cars this year, a little Christmas Bible for the kids. And also, Lee Strobel has written a book called The Case for Christmas. And everyone that goes through it will get a copy of that as well. So this is a really great evangelistic event. We want you to be a part of that. Also, if you take a look in your bulletins, there's some very important needs and things that we have. Again, next week, New Faces Luncheon. So if you're new with us and you've never been to one of our New Faces Luncheons, we'd like to invite you after the morning service. Come back, we'll have lunch, where we'll get to meet some of the pastors and the staff, give you a tour of the building, answer any questions you have. So if you're new with us and you've never been to one of those, please take advantage of that next Sunday after the service. Also, we're going to be needing some van drivers very soon, starting in January. We need to reschedule some things. So if you're available on Sunday morning, you can get here a half hour early and be willing to maybe once a month to be on call to go pick someone up that needs a ride for church. It doesn't happen all that often, but it happens often enough that I need somebody to be scheduled for that. So if you'd be willing to do that, please come see me or call the office during the week, and we'll get you on that schedule for that. We also have a really great need. This is Pastor Jace's fault, As you know, he has asked our ladies to have babies, and that's been going on for a number of years now. And right now, our twos and threes are just blowing up with kids. Very often, we have over a dozen kids in that group. And we need more help. And many of the moms are already involved in this. And part of the idea is to have a rotation so they can come down and enjoy the service as well. So some of you older moms and dads, we would love to have you give maybe one Sunday of every 6 or 8 weeks to go up and help with the twos and threes. We also need a teacher in the fours and fives. So we've had this in the bulletin for a while. This is a personal call from Pastor Bill to you folks to consider doing this. And in fact, if you would consider it, after I come down off the stage, I'm going to the back. And if you want to go up with me and take a walk around and take a look at how this is done and whether you'd like to be interested, I'll do that tour right now. So please consider that. We do need help in those areas. One last announcement. Maybe some of you know of Keith and Kristen Getty. They do an Irish Christmas down at the Kimmel Center. There are free tickets available for tomorrow night. And if you are interested in that, please see Timber Roman, and she'll make sure that you have access to those tickets. All right, Campbell, sit down.
Job. Thank you, Handbell. Handbells, no matter what they call, they always sound like Christmas to me. But I think it's because of that commercial. Remember that commercial with the Hershey Kisses? I think they played with, I forget what song it's like anyway. But great job. And as you can tell, Christmas is in full swing here. So we're going to be singing Christmas songs all month long. Because this December, and that's what we're going to do. So we're going to start off with Old Favor. Please stand as we sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Joy.
So, since you're visiting Berean for the first time, first of all, welcome. And what we do here every month is we learn a new song together. We call it the new song of the month. And believe it or not, this month, this is the 50th song of the month. You guys, after you've learned this one, have learned 50 songs. So go you. Good job. You're very talented. So, this is the season where we celebrate Christ's coming, you know, the first time. And we talk about peace, goodwill towards man. And what we want in this world is peace. Who doesn't want peace? But we have a wrong definition of peace. You see, we think peace means the absence of struggle, the absence of war. And here, believe me, I want that. I want the absence of struggle, the absence of war. But in this world, that's not going to happen. There's always going to be struggle. There's always going to be battle. That's just the world we live in. So, Jesus offers a peace to us while we're here going through it. And there's not an absence of struggle. It's a peace through the struggle. You see, in Psalm 46, when it says, be still and know that I am God, we've really messed up the understanding of that as to, you know, get away from the struggles of this life, go off into a field, and remember that God is there. God is with you even when you're not in the field. You see, the idea of peace, be still, or be still, know that I am God, is remembering that when the enemy is advancing towards you, when the very armies of Satan are heading at us, the battles and the struggles of this life, and sure, failure is coming our way. And we are terrified of that. We vacate ourselves, is what the word really means. Vacate yourself. Give yourself up and remember that God is on your side. And He goes before you as a mighty moving fortress to conquer all of that. So we can have peace in this life as long as we rest in Him. So this month we're going to learn a song called Peace Has Come. Because the Prince of Peace has come, and He's going to come again.
Behold the Star of Bethlehem, the Word of God has become flesh. Unto us a child is born, the Savior of this broken world. Oh, hear the angel voices sing, come, let us adore Him. Peace has come, for our King is with us.
Sing along if you got it.
Holy God and holy man, He comes for all with open hands. He'll rule with love on David's throne. All praise belongs to Christ alone. Oh, hear the angel voices sing, come, let us adore Him. Peace has come, for our King is with us. Holy, 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 Jesus, we adore Thee. Peace has come, for our King is with us. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore He in Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. Oh, hear the angel voices sing, come, let us adore Him. Peace has come, for our King is with us. For our King is with us.
Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you did come into this world. And thank you that peace has come to all who believe. Bless us this time again. Amen. Amen.
Morning. Our scripture reading is found in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. Again, John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. I will ask you guys to rise out of the respect of the reading of God's Word this morning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being by Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There came a man sent from God whose name was John. He came for a witness, that he might bear witness of the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came that he might bear witness of the light. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightened every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own, who were his own, did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. You may be seated. That's what Christmas is all about, when God became a man. Who would have thought that God would do that for us? Become a man and then die in our place. Now, Christmas is like this great season of a little baby being born, but without it, without Easter, Christmas is kind of just half the story. So what a great opportunity to be able to also remember what Jesus did on the cross for us at communion. As the ushers have come forward, they'll be receiving the general fund this morning. I want to bring into your focus the missionaries in focus at the bottom of the order of service. You see Roy and Sheila Schell over at Camp Tankenac, the DeVilbuses in North Carolina, Livingston's in France, and then our youth group here. I'll give you a couple moments to pray silently for whatever God has laid on your heart, as well as the missionaries in focus, and then I will lead us in a time of audible prayer. Let's go to the Lord. Father, how great you truly are. To think how you love sinful and fallen man. That again, that you loved us so much that you made a way that we could be restored back to you. Again, nothing that was accomplished by our hands, by our words, but was accomplished through what Jesus did on the cross. And so, Father, as we kind of head into this holiday season of Christmas and just all the hustle and bustle of preparing for this holiday, may we take time to remember when the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, knowing that that had to happen so that man could be redeemed. To think that the God of the universe was contained in a human body, lived a perfect, sinless life, an example that we could follow, and yet ultimately to die in our place, to pay the penalty of sin, a just penalty, and you paid it in full. And what a great opportunity that we had to remember that as well this morning at the communion table, to remember the sacrifice that was paid for us. Truly, what a great God we serve. And Father, as your word goes forth this morning from this pulpit and from the various Sunday school rooms, Father, I just pray that it would go forth in its boldness and in its power and in accuracy. Father, that we would have ears to hear, that our hearts would be fertile ground for your word, that we wouldn't be as some of the soils mentioned in the parables, that we wouldn't be hardened soil, that the adversary would come and pluck it away, nor would we be shallow and that it would wither during times of trouble, or that we would allow it to be choked out because of life's concerns, but that it would yield a crop beneficial to your service. Father, I also think of this morning's general fund. I pray for wisdom as this money comes in, that we would use it to further your kingdom for your honor and glory. Father, I ask that you would draw near to those that are laid aside, with health issues or a variety of other problems that they may be dealing with, that you would just draw near to them. Father, for those that are going through just a time of mourning for loss, that also that you would draw near to them at this time. Father, again, we thank you for this holiday season And may we be mindful of the crucible that is about your Son, Jesus, and that we would keep him in the forefront. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thanks to the handbellers. I know they've practiced quite a bit, and many of you really look forward to them. Before we begin, let's get up. Let's stretch your legs, greet somebody, wish them a merry Christmas. We'll start with a story. It's a little bit dated, but how many of you here, and this will show your age, how many of you here are familiar with John Wayne? John Wayne, come on. It's great, right? Look at these young people over here. I try to get my daughters to watch John Wayne movies with me. A lot of times they won't. It was a simpler day, wasn't it? The good guys were the good guys, and the bad guys were the bad guys. There's a story told of Ned and Fred who got together one Saturday afternoon to walk into town to watch the latest John Wayne movie at the theater. As they made their way into town, Ned told Fred that he was willing to bet $5 that John Wayne would be killed in the movie. Fred said that he'd take the bet. So they traveled down the road, and sure enough, the Duke, which is the nickname for John Wayne, was killed near the end of the picture, and Fred handed Ned $5. On the way home, Ned told Fred that he felt guilty for taking the money because he had seen the movie the week before. Fred just smiled and said, "Nah, you just keep the money. I watched it last week too, but I didn't think them fellers could kill John Wayne twice." John Wayne was bigger than life, wasn't he? But just like these men, you and I have been given insider information about the eventual end of the world as we know it. A lesson on adopting a biblical worldview challenges us to take what the Bible says about the future of the world seriously, and in light of what is going to happen to this world, to live accordingly. We know, as we've studied 2 Peter, that someday the Father will say it's time and Jesus will return. We're commanded to live our lives in light of Christ's return. keeping ourselves separated from the world and sharing our faith with the lost. And thus, we are, as believers, encouraged to be diligent, to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what this last section of 2 Peter is about. If you want to turn there with me, it's been a couple weeks since we've been there. But I want to remind you once again, we're going to be picking up in verse 14. But I'm going to read for you verses 10 through 13 to give you a little context once again. Where it says, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. Since all these things are be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, on account of which the heavens will be destroyed by burning, and the elements will melt with intense heat? But according to his promise, we are looking for the new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you look for these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, spotless and blameless." We're going to try to get through verse 14, 15, and 16 this morning. Verse 14 begins with the idea of being diligent in our discipline, in the discipline of our faith. As I said, this brings, this begins here, this last section down to through verse 18. Brings us to the conclusion of the matter, to the conclusion of 2 Peter. These things, he said, in light of these things, we're to be forward-looking. We're to be expectant for the things to come, for the kingdom of God, for the day of God, for new heavens and earth. He says, listen, there are troubling times ahead. There's actually coming eventually. You talk about climate change. You talk about global warming. The scriptures tell us that everything is going to melt with a fervent heat. That's not because of natural things, by the way. That's because of the judgment of God. But we have a hope. We have a blessed hope and a sure hope and a certain hope. The Lord is coming again for us. And that ultimately we're going to enter into the day of God, into a new heavens and a new earth. And armed with these truths of the Word, it's supposed to affect our conduct. You see, if you study the Scriptures and look at all of the epistles, you're going to see that the apostles always link the truth about our faith with the conduct that should follow. In other words, our creed should work itself out in conduct. Our beliefs should determine our behavior. And that looking for has a direct relationship to what you're living for, or it ought to. We shouldn't divorce ourselves from these things. Because that's what the false teachers did. The false teachers often severed the link between belief and behavior. And we're seeing that same error today. We're seeing people who are teaching that, you know, as long as you name the name of Jesus, it doesn't matter one bit the way that you live or your conduct. As long as you name the name of Christ, you don't have to change one iota. And I remind you to be certain, to be sure, that once you're saved, you're always saved. But that we need, first of all, to be certain, 100% certain, that we're saved. That we truly given our hearts to Christ. That we truly believe that we're sinners. That we truly believe that we're lost and have no hope without Him. And that only through the merits and the shed blood of Christ can we ever enter in to the day of God. Can we ever enter in and hope to be part of the new heavens and the new earth? So many today won't live that way. We also have the other extreme of that, the idea of salvation without doctrine, salvation without teaching, salvation that's not based or rooted and grounded in the Word of God. It's all about experience. And that's a really rising phenomenon within the body of Christ there, within the large umbrella of the church. And that anybody who studies the Word and adheres to the Word and stands by the Word, that we are legalists. Oh, you just have to experience things. You just have to experience Jesus. You can't experience Jesus divorced from the truth about Him. And because of the fact that many are trying to, there is a large amount, a great deal of false teaching circulating within the realm of the church. But the Scriptures teach us that doctrine leads us to diligence. That knowing the truth influences the way that we live. The way that we look at the world has a great impact on the way that we live in the world. And we have to be diligent in our faith. And it involves looking toward the truths of the Word. In Luke chapter 12, verse 37, Jesus said, "Blessed are those servants, those slaves, whom the master shall find on the alert when he comes." That's what this verse does. Therefore, beloved, since you look for these things, be diligent. Be active. This word in the Greek, this word diligent, it's a command. It's an imperative. And the word carries with it a sharp urgency, a need, a sense of duty, an intense eagerness to do quickly and enthusiastically the task that is set before us. When I was studying this word, I thought of, it's football season. And right now it's really getting intense because in college football, all the championships were yesterday and things. But every time you watch a football game, it doesn't matter if the team's the best or the worst, that when they come out to play, they come out of that tunnel and come onto the field, what do you see in them? An enthusiasm, right? They want to get to the game. They come charging out of the tunnel there, and sometimes there's a big long line of cheerleaders and things. There's smoke machines or banners to break through, and then they come out and they get in a big mob and they jump up and down and they're ready to go. They're enthusiastic. I don't know how many Christians have that kind of attitude about their faith and about living it out. You know, either side is wrong. If you try to live the faith without doctrine, you're going to fail. If you just have doctrine and no living of it, no practicality in it, you're going to be ineffective in the world and you're going to not have an impact upon the world. But I think a lot of Christians have put their faith on delay. They're not enthusiastic about it. They don't have the attitude to go forward, to do what God has commanded us to do, to live the way God has directed us to live, to follow the example of the Lord Jesus Christ. I think one of the greatest examples of this, and this is a passage that I know that we've looked at many times because it's such a fascinating passage. It's Abraham in Genesis chapter 22. And you know the story there of the offering of his son Isaac. In chapter 22 of Genesis says, "Now it came about that after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. And he said, Take now your son, your only son whom you love, Isaac, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will tell you." And we read that and we say, can you imagine getting that command of God to take your son, to take your child, to take your only child, and to take him to a place that he directs him to and says, there you're going to kill him and offer him as a sacrifice. Verse 3 is just so profound because, "So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split wood for the burnt offering, and he rose and he went to the place of which God had told him." I don't know about you, but if I had been commanded, I probably would have just flat out said no. But Abraham not only said yes, he didn't drag his feet. He didn't lollygag. Early in the morning, he went. I'd have put that off forever, right? I'd have put off being obedient to the Lord as long as I possibly could. And a lot of Christians live that way. Oh, we speak of our faith, but living for the Lord, there's always tomorrow. There's always the next day or next year. And some will soon come to the first of the year, and they're going to make those yearly, commitments and those things at New Year's that we do, and next year we'll have the same one again. Because we never put it into practice. You don't have the attitude that Abraham had toward God. He says, listen, be diligent to be found in him when he comes. The Lord is coming again. And when he comes, he's going to find us out. And when he comes, he expects us to be living in good behavior, to be diligently living for him. We don't do good deeds in order to be saved. Good deeds are the fruit of salvation. Good behavior is the fruit of what we have in Christ. Here in verse 14, he says, therefore, beloved, you who are beloved of God, remember that. He's not talking about beloved by me. He's talking about you're beloved of God. If you know him as your Savior, you're beloved of God. And since you look for these things, well, that should be the natural practice of all believers. To be forward-looking. Be diligent to be found in him. Christ is coming. You're going to see him, and we're going to see him face to face. You're going to be personally found by Christ. I remember when I was a kid, and we used to go to this old fur buyer, and he would always say, he said, oh, you got this, you got this. He said, I'll find you out. I'm going to find you out. I don't know what great mystery the old guy was looking for. As far as I know, he never found us out. But when Christ comes, he will find you. He'll know everything we've done. Everything about us will be brought to light. 1 John chapter 12, 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. He says, and now, little children, abide in him. Abide in the Lord, so that, Lord Jesus Christ, so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from him in shame at his coming. He's not talking about unbelievers there. He's talking about believers. He's talking about children of God. He says, you don't want to be ashamed when he comes because you haven't walked with him. Because your behavior hasn't been Christ-like. I have those opportunities. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's be diligent for that. We have to aspire unto that. So that you can be found in him in peace. In peace. Nick was talking about peace, saying it's more than just the absence of difficulties and trials. This word, peace, irene, in the Greek, says he's coming. He wants to be found in him in peace. It's more than just a quietness. It's an idea of prosperity. Prosperity of your soul and spirit of your body. Prospering spiritually, at peace with God, with others, with yourself. That's prosperous spiritually. And that's in spite of the circumstances in the world in which we live. I never said if you are one of my children, you're never going to go through difficulties or trials. That's a false teaching. That's an emotional thing with no basis in fact many times. Peace is being able to rise above the circumstance of life, or to go through them and not be knocked off your pegs, not have your relationship with others destroyed. See, our faith, when we are saved, it gives us peace with God. Right? When you come to know Christ, you're going to eternity. You're going into an eternity with Him. You're never going to be cast into hell. You have peace with God. The enmity between you and God was taken care of at the cross of Calvary. We were reconciled to God there. And so when you get saved, you have peace with God. And then your daily walk, if you daily walk with Him, in communion with Him, in fellowship with Him, that brings into your life the peace of God. So that when the trials and the situations and the difficulties that happen every day to us, everybody here is dealing with difficulties in their life. With sickness, with broken relationships, problems at work, problems at school, problems in the family, problems with yourself. A lot of people really don't like themselves. But if you walk in communion with God, if you endeavor, if you're diligent in your relationship with God, the peace of God will overcome you. And then that peace that you have with God will extend to peace with others and peace with yourself. There's a lot of believers who have peace with God, but not with themselves. They have peace with God, but not with others. Their life is in turmoil. They feel defeated and depressed and beaten down all the time. Peter wants us to be at total peace. Peter wants us to live lives that are not filled with depression or filled with fear and trials and difficulties. John spoke about it in 1 John chapter 4. Verse 17, listen, God loves you. God loves you. If you think nobody else in the world loves you, God loves you. First of all, I doubt that that's true, but even if it is, God loves you. And he says, by this love is perfected with us, that we may have confidence in the day of judgment, because as He is, so also are we in this world. Listen, there will be trials in the world. Jesus was perfect, and His love was for all, and look how they treated Him. But then in verse 18 is a terrific verse for those who struggle with their relationship with others, with their relationship with themselves. It says, there's no fear in love, but perfect love. The love of Christ casts out fear, because fear involves punishment, and the one who fears is not perfected in love. See, when we know what's coming, when we know what awaits us in glory, when we know what awaits us ultimately, the things that happen now are temporary. They can be troubling for a moment. They can be troubling for a time. It doesn't mean that they're not serious. But at the end of the day, it all goes away. And so I can function with the peace of God in my life, spotless and blameless. See, we can live lives without stain or blame. Without stain or blame, folks. The world is striving for that. They pay millions of dollars to try to get someone to fix them. And Jesus has done it. It cost Him His precious blood, but He extends that to us. When He talks about us here, He says, listen, be in peace. I'm going to get back to my passage here in 2 Peter. Be in peace, spotless and blameless. The reference here is not so much to our standing, our position in Christ, our justification, but by seeing our Savior, but what he's talking about is our character, our progressive sanctification, that we're saved, we're set apart to God positionally, but then we're supposed to live the way that live up to our position, or strive to, in daily practice, to build up our moral character, to be spotless, and to live as blameless in the world. Isn't that a startling word for you? To be blameless? To be blameless? How can we be blameless after the things that we've done? How can we be blameless? Because of the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of our sin being washed away. Remember it says in Isaiah chapter 1:18, apply it to yourself. Though your sins be like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. We can only be blameless because we're forgiven. Because Christ has forgiven us. And listen, what I really like about this, when I read this, I was reminded of Peter chapter 1 and verse 19. Okay, I'll start at 18 to give you context. Knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with the precious blood as of a lamb, unblemished and unspotless, the blood of Christ. The same phrase, just reversed order there. We were saved by the Lamb of God, by Jesus Christ, who is unblemished and spotless. He is our ideal of purity. He is our example of how we ought to live. See, doctrine without any kind of practice behind it is, in the practical sense, it gives us little in this realm of time to lay hold on. He says, listen, follow after the example of blamelessness and spotlessness. Because if you'll remember in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, what do you say about these false teachers who are twisting and torturing the Scriptures? 2 Peter 2, 13. He said, these false teachers are stains and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions as they carouse with you. You follow after the false teachers and you're going to lose your diligence for the things of the Lord. And you'll lose your security. And you'll lose your victory. Because their teachings are hung upon nothing. And they cannot stand. So be diligent in your faith. Be diligent in your discipline. But also be diligent in the delay. That's verse 15. It says, in regard to patience of our Lord to be salvation, just as also our beloved Paul, according to the wisdom given him, wrote to you. Remember that one of the things that Peter was telling us or teaching us was that because the Lord has delayed in his return doesn't mean he's not going to do it. As the false teacher saying, there is no coming of the Lord. Certainly not a physical one. You just need to live your life because the way things are, they're going to continue to be. So it shall ever be. Reminded me of the Mount St. Helens in Washington in the eruption there on March 20th, 1980. A supposedly dormant volcano began to quake and rumble. The local population was evacuated to a safe, what was considered a safe distance, 8 miles away. Later, the side of the mountain began to bulge. But scientists were not alarmed. Here's our scientists who in our society is held up as infallible. But scientists were not alarmed because past research of volcanoes indicated, if you like that word better, said that volcanoes never blew out the side. They always blow out the top. But on May 18th, the side of Mount St. Helens exploded, shooting tons of debris downhill at the speed of 150 miles an hour. How far does 150 miles get to 8 miles away, right? Safe distance. This will never happen. A minute later, the volcano exploded upward. So it went outward and upward, something scientists said couldn't possibly happen, with the equivalent power of 500 atomic bombs going off at once. Do you fear the power of man or the power of God? 230 square miles of forest were devastated. 57 people lost their lives. It's just good it was a very remote area. Because the scientists had assumed that natural events would continue as they always have before. But they were wrong. They were wrong. Peter says, instead of going the way of the world, you need to regard the patience of our Lord. Another imperative here. Consider the facts. Consider what you've been taught. And then you make a decision. And continue. It's a present imperative. Continually consider the reasons that the Lord would delay. Killing even believers because, oh, you know, we've heard about the Lord returning forever. I don't know if it's ever going to happen. I know a lot of churches, Pastor, don't believe that anymore. And so far, they've been right. Delay isn't denial, folks. And he tells us, listen, you better consider which way you're going to go with this. Because this word, regard or consider here in verse 15, involves careful thought, not a quick decision. Words hegiomai, we've seen it before in our study. But an excellent illustration of the meaning of it is found in the life of Moses. And it's spoken about in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verses 24 to 26, where it says, by faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasure of sin. Why did he make this choice? Because he was considering, hegiomai, the reproach of Christ greater to be greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Moses thought through his decision, weighing the pros and the cons. He weighed what Egypt had to offer against what God offered. And Egypt had considerable things to offer, didn't it? The son of Pharaoh. When he reached the conclusion, it was well-founded and certain. God's offer, even though unseen, was infinitely superior to Pharaoh's offer that could be seen. Moses believed that the worst that he could endure for Christ would be far more valuable than the best the world had to offer. That's the kind of accounting that you and I need to do. And he says, what's the delay? Well, delight in the delay because opportunities abound. He said, regard the patience of our Lord to be salvation. What's he talking about there? He's saying, listen, God is long-suffering. And the long-suffering of God gives opportunity for repentance and salvation. You know, I say, oh, Lord Jesus, come for us now. Oh, Lord, when you return and set up your kingdom, what a wonderful world that will be. But all in all of delay, God delays for what? The repentance of men. God wants and desires that he might be gracious and long-suffering and not willing that any should perish. Remember what it said in verse 9. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. So yes, I say, oh Lord, come, but in the meantime, what should we be doing? Sharing the gospel. Working out our own salvation. Growing in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. one of the great facts of the history of the world between the history of the world between the first and the second coming of Christ is that it's the age of salvation. That God holds out that opportunity of people to come to Christ. So that when we see things in the world around about us, we can have patience, knowing that God is long-suffering and patient. When I see terrorists take up arms in our own nation and attack people in San Bernardino, California, part of me says, Lord, strike them down. And when I see the Daily News in New York take up the headlines, God isn't going to fix this, and mock those who pray, and giving the idea that not only God isn't, God can't, God won't, because there probably isn't a God, and all of your prayers are nothing. I got patience in that. Because our nation doesn't deserve God to fix this, does it? But I know that ultimately God will fix it. And we're going to be there when He does. And it's going to be glorious when He does. And I tell you, and I tell you, and I tell you that I love being right. Don't you love being right? And so when we go out and witness that Christ is going to solve this situation, we're going to be right. And I don't think it's really biblical, but if the Lord lets me, I'm going to say, I told you so to some people. It's wonderful to go into a situation and know that you have the truth. But if you want to be effective with that truth, you have to live it out. And the delay is nothing to be concerned about. Salvation for us. In the past, we can live in the sense of all three tenses of our salvation. In the past, Christ died for us, and we were justified in Him. As we wait now, it gives us time to be working out our salvation, progressively being set apart from the world and unto God, witnessing for Him, being delivered more and more from the sin of this world and the habit of this world and the failure of this world. That's our progressive sanctification. And all this past and present salvation is in preparation for our future salvation, when we will be completely, fully delivered, not only from the presence of sin, but even the pleasure of it. It will hold no draw to us any longer. When we understand these things, we can put them into practice in our life. And so it brings us back to verse 16, where it may seem that I'm beating a drum with all of our preaching, but the Scriptures beat it. And so do I, where it tells us to be diligent in our doctrine. As also in all his letters, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which the untaught and unstable distort, as they do also the rest of the Scriptures to their own destruction. Listen, one reason why we keep pounding upon the Scriptures and about their importance, and about not abandoning them, and about not twisting them and distorting them and reinterpreting them, is because the Scriptures are the matter of eternal life and eternal death. They're the matter of life and death. Peter and Paul and the apostles agree over and over again. Peter says, listen, Paul's told you this as well. We agree. Some of the things of Scripture are very simple, even a child can understand. Some things that Paul has given us are hard. They're difficult. It reminds me of a story from the Daily Bread, told about Wilbert Welch, who was the chancellor of Grand Rapids Baptist College and Seminary. He would tell a story about one of the professors, Dr. Brokenshire, a godly and gifted scholar with a thorough knowledge of scriptures. And he said he remembered that on the first day in class, this professor, Dr. Brokenshire, didn't know anybody by name. So he would refer to some of the cards in his hands of the students' information. Looking up, he said, "Mr. Green." And the student identified himself. "Here." "Mr. Green," he said, "do you have any problems with the Bible?" "No, sir," replied the confident new student. Brokenshire replied, "Then why don't you read it, and you will." Some things in Scripture are hard to understand. Peter saying that, and he was an apostle. And I think he said it, and especially in light of the writings of Paul. And I agree with him. But many things are simple. A thoughtful reading of the Bible will raise questions. But God wants us to study the Bible. And he wants us to question his word. Because a questioning mind is a fertile soil for learning. Some things will remain a mystery, and we must humbly accept God's right to withhold knowledge from us. But no matter what problems we have in understanding the Scriptures, we can thank him that he has revealed sufficient truth to win our hearts, to guide our steps, and to bring us to heaven. And that the more that we study, the more we will understand. I tell you over and over again, and I don't think I should have to. I hope it isn't here, Brian, but in the body, without the Church of America, I would say this is true. That people need to be reminded that we must be people of the book. We must be people of the book. John Wesley wrote in the preface of his standard sermons, "I am a spirit come from God and returning to God, just hovering over a great gulf, till a few moments hence I am no more seen. I drop into an unchangeable eternity. I want to know one thing, the way to heaven. He hath written it down in a book. Oh, give me that book. At any price, give me the book of God. I have it. Here is knowledge enough for me. Let me be homo unius libre," which means a man of one book. Oh, that we might be a people of the book. For blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. That's a quote from Psalm 1. May our practice be in accordance with the true teachings of the Word of God. I've got to stop there because we're going to go to communion, but I'm going to end you with this thought. Listen, this Word, we need to both learn it and live it. You can't live it if you haven't learned it, and if you learn it and don't live it, you're not going to be effective in your life, you're not going to be effective in your witness, and you're going to always wonder, am I truly a child of God? Bring these together for the glory and the honor of the Lord Jesus Christ, and for your own well-being and the well-being of others. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Pray that we would be not only hearers of the word, but doers of the word. And Father, we would be people who have peace in these troubling times in which we live, that people would see us as ones who are stable, who are at peace, spotless, blameless, bringing glory and honor to your name. And Father, having a right relationship with you, with ourselves, and with others. Pray and ask it in Jesus' name.
Please stay.
He did it for you and me, the long walk to Calvary, where he took away our sin. But look at what they did to him. He was beaten and abused, but never once did he refuse to take on the orders of our brigade, to the cross and to the grave. We still love and forgive, show the curtain and in grace. Close again in 3 days, change the world and our faith. What they did to him. Many people, they don't believe eternal life they can't receive. Can't get their mind around that true love that can't be found. Just through his wounds that we are here, all we have to do is you. Believe in him and all that's true. He wants to live a life with you. Took away all our sin, but look at what we did to him. Look at what we did to him. What we did to him. Look what you and I did to him. Because of our sin, Christ went to the cross of Calvary. He did it willingly. He did it out of love. And because of him, he made possible peace with God. And everything that we have is tied to that. We can't have the peace of God without first having peace with God. And then he commanded us, he said, do these things in remembrance of me. Remember what Christ did for us in the past. But also remember what it does for you in the here and now. And what it does for you in the future. Do it in remembrance of him. The table is for those who know Christ as their Savior. We can't remember him that we've never known. It's something we remind people of all the time. The wonderful thing is that if you've never received Christ as your Savior, you can do it even now. You do have to admit that you're a sinner. You have to admit that there's no way to heaven except through Jesus Christ, that you can't get there by being a good person or through good deeds, joining a church. You could join the Berean Bible Church and never get to heaven. You get to heaven by having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, with him alone. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one, nobody, not one. No one comes to the Father except through me. Right? He said, I am the door, didn't he? I am the door. There's only one doorway into heaven, and it's Jesus Christ. There's only one doorway for life everlasting, for life that's fulfilling, for life that's victorious, for life that's diligent. Remember him with us today. I'm going to give you a few moments to prepare your hearts. And then we invite you to join us at the table of the Lord as we remember the great price that was paid so that we have life and have it everlastingly and have it completely and abundantly. Let's pray. The scriptures tell us that in the night in which the Lord Jesus was betrayed, that he took the bread, blessed it, broke it, he passed it out to his disciples, and he said, take it, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Deacons, Bo Jean, to return thanks for the body of the Lord Jesus.
Gracious Lord, God, I just want to thank you for taking my sin, Lord, and everybody's sin in the world, bearing all the pain and the agony and death for us.
Sorrows, what I made for the Son of God who came, who is sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior. There is shame and stopping room in my place, God held he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah.
As we partake of the bread, which is a symbol of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ offered up for us on that day on the cross of Calvary, let us thank Him together by saying, I thank You, Lord Jesus, for Your body, which was given for me. I thank You, Lord Jesus, for Your body, which was given for me. Now, as you partake, remember the Savior.
You know, what I hold in my hand here from a literal perspective is a very simple thing. It's a cup of, is it Welch's? Who would know that? Is it Welch's or is it a Kano brand? Is it Kano brand? Oh, my goodness. We need, Pastor, to work on that. But, you know, Jesus gave this cup an amazing different meaning. What you're about to hold in your hand is something wonderful. It's the plan of God from eternity past and His love for humanity to take away our sin, our failings, all the time we've dropped the ball, and to put it on His only Son, one who is innocent. And paying the price for us and shedding His blood, we could have salvation and the hope of eternity. And that truth is reminded to us again and again when we experience loss or difficulty. Just even experienced the loss of my stepfather and our deacon, you know, dear Deacon Paul. But I know that this was his hope and confidence. And it's also all of ours. But in this cup is the plan of salvation from start to finish. As we remember what Christ did for us and the great future that we have with Him. ask Elder Allen to return thanks to the call.
Father, as once again come thanking you for this gift of salvation, my words always fall short. Thank you for your willingness to send your Son. And Jesus, we thank you for your willingness to come and die in our place, in my place. For there is no other way that salvation could have been brought about but through that. And we are thankful, and we love you, and we offer it in your strong name. Amen.
Hope with God that binds day, the whole earth quakes and loves display. 3 days silent in the ground, his body born for heaven's crown. On that bright and glorious day, when heaven opened up the grave, he's alive and visiting me. Oh, praise him for the mercy tree. Death is thy love as one. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. Death is thy love as one. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. One day soon we'll see his face. Every tear he'll wipe away. No more pain or suffering. Oh, praise him for the mercy free. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. Death has died, love has won. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus Christ has overcome. He has risen from the dead. On a hill called Calvary stands an endless mercy.
Dear saints of God, as you look into the cup, the emblem, the symbol, the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, see in its shimmering surface the depth of love that the Father had for you. He would send his only Son on your behalf to rescue you from sin, to give you hope of eternity, and to constantly remind you of his wonderful love for you. As you drink, consider the wonder of the cross. Join with me in a simple prayer. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood, which was shed for me. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood, which was shed for me.
We know because of his shed blood, the salvation was made once for all to whom believe. And what an amazing certainty in that. That is nothing because not because of the works that we've done, though we live lives that try to honor God with the way we do, with the way that we live, the way we act, we understand that our salvation is not rested upon us. Our salvation is rested on the finished work of Jesus Christ. We believe in that. We have a certainty that we will see Him. We have a certainty that heaven is waiting for us. So please stand as we sing Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. There is salvation, purchase of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior and happy and blessed. Watching His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Holy Father, we thank You for everything. We thank You for life. We thank You for creating us. We thank You for giving us a way to not fear death. We thank You for peace. We thank You for assurance. We thank You for this season that gives us an opportunity to show the world what true peace and goodwill towards men really looks like, and that's being lights to this world. To show them the reason for this season is You. Taking on flesh and dwelling among us. And the Lord bless you and keep you. God's His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.